I'm your host, Jim McLean. Welcome to a brand new series of the Bantaflix Movie Review Podcast, or as we've dubbed it now, More Than Pixels on a Screen. It's a new name for the pod, but it's the same old voices. On this episode, I'm joined by one half of Bantaflix's sleuth sisters and our deputy editor, Joe Mc Elroy.
Hello, Jim. How are you?
I'm good. It's good to have you in the pod. We're here in the studio. As I said, when we made our little attempt to reboot the pod last year, we're not doing it over Zoom, although we will be doing podcasts this series over Zoom again, but we're in a studio physically. I can reach out and touch you, Joe.
I see you, Jim.
I see you. Yes. Oh, there we go. You can see where we're going with our reference already. So this week we're going to be talking about Avatar, The Way of the Water, which is officially now the highest grossing film of 2022. Poor old Tom Cruise must be just sitting, raging at the Navi, just sitting there with his wee small tiny fist.
He's just going to keep re-releasing Top Gun until he tops it.
Maybe he doesn't figure it. Maybe he doesn't know yet because he's too busy just jumping out of planes. Tom, we've got a bit of information for you. Can't speak. But anyway, I don't know where I went with that reference. But anyway, yes, we're going to be talking about Avatar, The Way of the Water, the latest film from James Cameron. So before we get into talking about that, let's play a clip of the film.
Why do you come to us?
I just want to keep my family safe.
Treat them as our brothers and sisters. Teach them our ways.
Keep up, forest boy!
If you want to live here, you have to ride.
Let's do it.
Just breathe.
So that's a clip of The Way of the Water. Joe, I see you.
I see you too, Jim.
I see you. Well, I don't actually see you because you can kind of see your forehead.
Monitor blogging us.
Okay, so we're going to be talking about this, but very quickly, in true Bantaflix style, let's ramble back to 2009. Were you a fan of the original film in this series?
I was, but in the strangest thing, I seen it once in cinemas and then I didn't watch it ever again until this one was coming out. It's not that I thought it was bad or anything. I just didn't feel the need to go back to Pandora. But then, of course, James Cameron, he coaxed me back and here we are now.
Yeah, because I was the same. I watched this in the cinema. I watched it in 3D. I'm guessing that's how you watched it when it was in the cinema.
Yeah.
And was never a massive fan. My memory of that experience, I had hurt my foot playing football. So I remember just hobbling into the cinema, hobbling out and kind of going, oh, not really. I don't know how to put this. I never disliked Avatar, but I never loved it. And like you, I've never felt the need to revisit it. I did decide to watch it in the run-up to going to see this in this the latest film in the cinema. And I had to watch it over two sittings because I fell asleep. So that was what, it was under 3 hours long. This new release is 3 hours, 15 minutes. So it is over the 3 hour mark. James Cameron has promised us, what, 4 more installments beyond this, depending on its final box office, which looks at this stage pretty good. It's, I think he said it has to make $2 billion to break even. It's already at 1.5 globally. Yeah. So it's going to hit that figure. You think about how many films James Cameron has in that top 10 of all time. Titanic's up there. Avatar's up there. I think that's it. But, you know. Sounds good.
Well, the thing is that there was a thing released today. He's the only filmmaker to have 3 films that made over $1.5 billion. So I think he's doing all right.
I bet he's got a t-shirt with that.
Oh, yeah. Big thing.
Just walking around. He's got a t-shirt for that. I think, because I know in an upcoming episode, we are going to be talking about another James Cameron film, True Lies. That was your pick. We're going to be talking about that in a couple of weeks. But I am a fan of James Cameron. I do love him as a filmmaker. Avatar was okay. I was impressed by what he did visually. I think the 3D thing kind of didn't really do anything for me. I know that this new film is released in about 17 gazillion different formats. There's the high-res, high-res 3D, high-res IMAX, all that. IMAX. The 3D IMAX. I seen it on plain, good old bog standard big screen at my local cinema in Lisburn. What did you go for?
I went to see it in IMAX 3D.
Okay.
And from what I hear, it is very different. I don't know about you, but did the frame rates change throughout the film for you? Or was it just consistently just a normal thing?
I can't remember. It didn't jar with me. Because remember a couple of years ago, this could be like a decade. I think was it the last Transformer film when Michael Bay was playing about with IMAX cameras and it was released in cinemas and there was a whole issue about the frame rate just changing drastically. That bothered me because I don't really like Michael Bay and I wasn't that invested with what was on screen. But I remember noticing that during that film. Maybe I need to go and rewatch it again. Maybe this is the lie that James Cameron is filling us with. That's why it's making $1.5 billion. Because he's just putting it out on Twitter. Yeah, guys, there's issues with the frame rate and bits and bobs. Did you notice that? No, I didn't. Maybe I'll go back and rewatch it. Like, fuck it, you've done it again.
Yeah, sure, he said something along the lines anyway. You know, people were complaining, don't you think 3 hours is too long? It's like, oh, if you miss it from bathroom break, you can always go again and rewatch that part that you missed.
Yeah, that's the way.
He's got a titty. He knows what he's doing.
He knows exactly what he's doing. Just maybe not with the more recent Terminator installments, but, nah. You know, he's only there in a kind of advisory capacity or helping out. When, you know, there's a paycheck involved. He's not actually directing. He's clever enough that way. So, Avatar, The Way of the Water. It was out in cinemas just before Christmas. There's not much else out in terms of big heavy hitters. I don't really think what's going to be the big release before the end of the year. Probably the next Marvel film, I can think. Or actually, well, I tell you, like, there's like The Fableman and stuff like that. But whether that's box office gold, I don't know. So what did you think, Joe?
Well, just going in, I think the best way to describe it is it's better than the first one. I think it's far, far better. I think just in terms of how characters have been developed in this one, and it's more sort of emotional resonance because it's a more family-orientated film, just to sort of plug the Fast and the Furious franchise. It is very Vin Diesel-heavy in that way. But I did enjoy it a lot more. I think even the visuals and the effects of really advanced over the 13 years, because like I said, I watched the original the night before going to see this one, and it's almost like night and day, because just the clarity and like how, you know, their character, even when you just see a close up of a hand sweeping through water, it just looks seamless, looks photorealistic. And then as for the actual story itself, it's just sort of indicative of what James Cameron does best in terms of escalation of action. Like, he'll give you a set piece, but it builds and builds and builds, and then you have a big grand epic third act, you know, and it works really well here because of the time he takes to develop all the characters throughout it. But I just thought it was just a brilliant piece of spectacle.
Yeah, I enjoyed this much more than I thought it would. I enjoyed it much more than the first film. I think it's got a clear idea. It's got a clear idea of what it wants to do, or I guess not so much clear idea, but just more straightforward in terms of what it's trying to do. You know, Alvin would be proud, as you've alluded to, the fact that it's family focused. We have Jake and I can never remember Zoe Saldana's.
Oh, Neytiri.
I can never remember her name. They have now raised a family together, and now, due to various reasons, I guess we'll maybe do a little spoiler alert at some point with this film and say, look, if you haven't watched it, you know, go see it and, you know, help James get the $2 billion that he so desperately needs. But I think there's certain plot points that may be kind of verging into spoilerific territory that we can kind of have to talk around at this stage. I think it's much more kind of streamlined in what it wants to do, although it is longer, as we've already mentioned. Visually, like you say, I think it is absolutely stunning. And one thing that, I don't know if that's a good thing or a bad thing, I was thinking of throughout my time watching the film, how below par or how, I mean, this is setting, once again, like Avatar did in 2009, it sets a new benchmark for special effects. It makes you realise, particularly some of the most recent output from the MCU, how shite some of the special effects. And I mean, I'll throw in, I know you didn't like the film either, the last Jurassic Park film, or Jurassic World, as it was called now for all the cool kids, how shite some of the special effects. So he has taken his time. He stepped away. This has been a labor of love for a while. He has went full Navi. He's created a culture, and I think he's created a whole language for it. And there's all these different communities and different races on the planet of Pandora that he has all got an outline there. So he's fully formed that in that way. But from just a visual point of view, like you've mentioned, special effects are stunning, but it just blows everything out of the water and makes you realise, I know I'm repeating myself, how shite some of the special effects have been in recent blockbusters.
Yeah. No, you're absolutely right, because I think what's key to that there is the fact that he has taken 13 years to develop this. I know he had, time developing scripts. He realised, okay, well, this isn't really going to be one story, it's going to be two and then three stories or whatever. So he created like a writer's room to try and, pad the thing out to a substantial story over a course of a few films rather than just the one. But at the same time, in that time, effects have developed, and in the background, he was working on, making sure they were up to par and as good as they could possibly be. Whereas you watch something like, or even you hear news of like the next Marvel film, they seem to just rush through things. And from reports you hear, at the last minute they decide to change scenes altogether, and it gives the special effects teams little to no time to try and do the best job possible, which is why they come out, below par. And like you mentioned Jurassic World Dominion there's a scene in it where I think like one of the raptors is just running through force, and it looks like it's just moving in a smooth straight line. It doesn't look like a creature actually running. It's just like a straight,
But that's how dinosaurs hunted, Joe.
Well, maybe. We don't know. Mm-hmm. They could have had, scientists on board to say, no, see that actually walking like an actual animal. They didn't do that. They just glided like Dracula into a room,
James Cameron would know.
He knows. He knows.
You'd be waiting about 15 years for the next Jurassic World film, but he would know.
Well, he was actually supposed to do the original Jurassic Park, but then he realised, I think Spielberg got in before him. He's like, yeah, you got a point there, Stephen.
Okay, so there's a lot of kind of unpack what we're kind of saying. I didn't know what to expect when I went in. I have talked for quite some time on the TV show, just among friends. I've really struggled to muster any enthusiasm for the film, because it was like, who is it really for? It's been that long since the first one was out. Was there really a need for another trip to Pandora? Not the shop, the planet. Do we need more unobtainium? And clearly James Cameron has moved on from unobtainium, because it's not mentioned anymore. There's much more of a kind of eco thread and kind of a global conscious about kind of what's going on in the world, and we need to kind of preserve nature things, because there's space wheels, listeners.
Free Willy in space.
Free Willy in space. You went full Pandora, because you, before we started recording, knew almost instantly the name of what this. I just call them space wheels.
I don't know. I think they're like.
I just built you up, Joe, as a Navi expert, and you're like, that's like taking some of the Jurassic words. Like, what do you call them?
When it comes to dinosaurs, I know them. I have an encyclopedic knowledge because of my love for dinosaurs as a child. So don't even go into that. Don't pull on that thread.
Listeners, email in your questions for Joe and all things dinosaur related.
Tell me, what is your favorite thing about a pachycephalosaurus? Yeah.
Well, what's yours?
Just the big dome head on them. Remember in Lost World, just knocks your fella through the car door? Amazing.
Yeah. I just prefer T-Rexes. Great killers, but tiny hands. Oh, right, yeah. Okay, we're getting sidetracked to talk about Jurassic World. And I often like to talk about Jurassic World. So, I don't know. Were you excited about this? I mean, as much as I love James Cameron as a filmmaker, there is a part of me that does kind of rue the fact that for two films, we're talking here, so 2009, I'm trying to think what his last, was his last film really, because I know he did some projects, was his last film before that, Titanic?
Yeah, there was a few documentaries
in
between.
That was 97, I think, so that's 97, 2009, now 2022. The amount of films we could have maybe seen him make if he hadn't just went full kind of full native with Navi. I don't know, there is that part of me that does sit and go, as much as I love and appreciate these films as a big screen spectacle, there is a part of me goes, I wish maybe we would have got one or two more films from James Cameron rather than just being so deep on these. Yeah. But coming back to my my question where I went off on a tangent. You know, as I said, listeners, new podcast, same old problems. Did you, or were you excited about this film in the run-up to its release?
Well, excited is probably not the word I would use. I'd say it's more along the lines of intrigued. I was really, you know, interested in knowing, like, what's he going to do with this now? You know, okay, because when we last leave things off, Jake has just, you know, officially become a Na'vi. Mm-hmm. You know, he's transferred his consciousness into the Na'vi body. So it was like, right, where's this going to go? And then you start hearing elements, oh, it's about him and Neytiri's family and humans are coming back to Pandora and stuff like that. So I was like, okay, well, I'm curious to know how they're going to continue that with trying to do something new and different than just a bog standard blockbuster. But at the same time, it's a case of, I'm always interested to see what James Cameron can put on screen next, because he always seems to try and top himself in every possible way, be it story or, like you said, special effects earlier. Like, he's always someone who's looking to test himself and push the boundaries of film.
Yeah, because I know we're going to be talking about True Lies in a couple of weeks. You know, generally you think about James Cameron. He's another one a bit like Chris Nolan. He's always, over the years, tried to do so much in camera. Throughout, I think we think of the Terminator films, particularly Terminator 2, with those special effects and some of the big action sequences. True Lies is another one I know, as I say, we're going to be talking about. But he tries to do so much in camera. Then I was always intrigued kind of when he's doing that. So it's all through mocapping and things like that. And, you know, still, because I think I read somewhere Kate Winslet is in this film and she's broke. There's another reason Tom will be raging, because I think she broke his record for being underwater, for holding her breath underwater.
Yeah, hers is like 7.5 minutes, and I think he only managed like just close to 7 minutes with the Mission Impossible film.
Tom's going to hate Avatar. He's like, that fucking film, those blue fucking Smurfs in face, in space.
James Cameron's going to kill him, because he's going to like go, okay, seeing Dead Reckoning Part 2, I'm going to hold my breath for 10 minutes. I don't care. It's just going to be, the opening's going to be like the video to No Surprises, just his head under a bowl of water for 10 minutes, holding his breath. That's all it's going to be. And
you know what? I'd pay to watch that.
So would I.
On the big screen. IMAX. In IMAX.
3D. I want to be in that bowl with him, you know?
Yeah, I'm up for that. So Tom, if you're listening, you know, for Dead Reckoning 3, you know, because the first two, you've already kind of done, you know, after that big jump in the helicopter, or after that big jump, he's just going to jump down and just get his head on a bowl, a big fish bowl.
He's going to do the jump with the bowl on his head. That's how he's just pushing the boundaries of, you know, in camera stunts. He doesn't care.
Tom Cruise, listeners, pushing the boundaries of cinema and etc. So I kind of forget where we went with that. I kind of got Tom Cruise.
If I was excited for Avatar.
Yes, excited for Avatar. I think the trailers just didn't do anything for me. They were seemingly like, oh, it's like how great it is to be back in Pandora. And they didn't realize, you know, I am the hypocrite. I am the biggest hypocrite on this podcast, because I hate trailers that give away what everything's about. But then when we get a trailer that it's like, oh, here we are back in Pandora, sweeping camera, space whales, and et cetera, et cetera. You're like, well, give me a fucking clue about what it's about. And I could never muster any excitement. And I know a lot of people got excited about the last one, which seemed to be much more violence heavy, and I know that's something I know we can talk about, because James Cameron has kind of said over the years his attitudes to gun violence have changed. He wouldn't make the type of films he made before, you know, True Lies, the Terminator films, etc., Aliens, because of his reaction to the mass shootings in America and throughout the globe, basically, and his attitudes. So I think he cut 12 minutes of footage from the final film, just to say he just more or less called them gun pornography. So, I mean, it's interesting to see and hear him evolving as a filmmaker. But coming back, and as we kind of record that, a little face of him just popped up. But anyway, it's interesting to hear of him evolving as a filmmaker. And yes, as you've mentioned, and come back to what you said, Joe, he did and he has pushed boundaries with the CGI. I thought the film was perfectly fine, serviceable, enjoyed it much more than the first one. I think it is long. I was never bored, but it did feel like I was watching like the Lord of the Rings extended cuts by Peter Jackson. There was times I go, if you really needed, you could cut this down to at least 2.5 hours. Now, I texted you, because we recorded the Christmas episode of the Envy TV show, which is available on our YouTube channel, where we talked about 4 different Christmas carols, and it was a lot of fun. We all felt very festive, but you came in very enthusiastic and you were the one person that made me go, okay, I'm going to make an effort to see this. Went to see it on the 30th of December, last cinema trip for the year. And yeah, thoroughly enjoyed it, loved it. But I came out of it and said, you know what? I think the first thing I texted you was, yeah, I really enjoyed it, but too much space wheels. Too much his best friend is a wheel.
I knew what I responded to you. That was my favourite part of the film.
Do you want to tell our listeners exactly what that sequence? Because, well, we should mention, so, you know, in typical Banderflix way, we've went off on a tangent. We've kind of went full kind of down that whole rabbit hole. We don't know where how to get ourselves back. So you've talked about this installment being much more family focused. We have family members with Sam Worthington's character and Zoe Saldana's character. They've now set up a family in Pandora. That family is threatened. They have to leave the jungle and go to the oceans. The different race, bigger tails and...
They're more water-based.
Water-based. There we go. There's a nice kind of slimline way of saying that. And it just so happens, I think it's Jake's second oldest son.
Yeah.
Because that is one thing I will criticise. So apart from we have Sigourney Weaver back, I don't know whether how much of a spoiler or not that is.
I don't think it is. Everyone knows she's on the posters and everything. She's promoted
poster.
The film.
She's on the poster. She's promoting it, but she's not playing the character she was in the first film. She's now reincarnated. Is she reincarnated?
She's not. No. The weird thing is she was born from her Navi avatar. So they're wondering, like, well, who got her up the duff when she was
there's a lot of Navi. There's a lot of people talk about that. They do make a lot of references to who knocked her up. But yes, so she's their adopted daughter, but they have three.
Yeah.
They have two boys and a girl. The second oldest, I'm going to say, is struggling to find his place. He doesn't get on too best with the locals. They set him out to sea, and there's a bit like Moby Dick-esque monster who just happens to befriend, and his best friend becomes a whale who is in space. And I felt... There was, as much as I liked the sentiment behind it, it was like, okay, we really don't need more footage of him just staring into, you know, Space Whale's eyes. Tell me what happened. Tell me about your day, Space Whale.
Yeah. No. You mock and you joke. But that... Oh, God. No. The thing about that there section...
What's that, Space Whale?
No, but I think that part is, you know, it's as long as it needs to be, because it really adds to, you know, the satisfaction you get from the third act when it happens, right? But it's because them two characters are basically outsiders and within their own sort of communities, and that the way they're able to come together and form a friendship, I thought was nice. It's a nice thing, and it's a nice touch that you don't see in a lot of blockbusters now, where they take the time to sort of, you know, delve into these sorts of themes. Everything seems a bit too rushed now, or they have to replace it with a quip or forced comedy, and it doesn't work all the time. Whereas this here, you know, was a bit more, like I was saying, a bit more emotional resonance in it.
I get that, and I'm not disagreeing with you. I just think it's, if I was to sit and say, right, we accuse filmmakers like Quentin Tarantino, like your stuff could be edited with a chainsaw. I'm not saying cut it. I'm just saying you could remove maybe
streamline
10 minutes off it. 10 minutes of...
Here, that wheel made me cry, so stop doing that.
That's the key thing I wanted to say, because you didn't say... I was kind of get you to put you on the spot to say that that sequence made you cry.
Yeah, there's like a flashback sequence. Like, the wheel has a flashback sequence. I know that sounds stupid offhand, but watch the film and you'll understand completely and you will bawl your eyes out. It's very sad.
Okay, I think with the fact that we've mentioned that one of Jake's children has a best friend who's a whale, I think we've ventured into spoiler territory. So I think what we should do now is say to anyone, if you've got this far and you haven't watched the film, I think we'll maybe say, look, come back, or if you don't care, you know, we're going to play some whale sounds. And then...
We already have.
We're going to play some professional whale sounds, some whales on Earth, and then come back and we'll talk in spoilerific detail. So you can't say we didn't warn you. So, Joe, the Earth whales have warned us. We're now in spoilerific territory. So, I guess, you know, I don't know how much of a spoiler it is. So, we have Stephen Lang is back. Is it Quaritch?
Yeah, Quaritch.
Well, he's not really back. So there's a Navi clone of him who just very... I mean, this is my thing, right? So we spend 15, 20 minutes, you know, going off about how his best friend is a space whale. And there's just like a second where they go, right, see this box? Yeah, see this box? It doesn't really work as an audio medium, but see this box, guys? This is all Quaritch's memories from the first one up until a certain point. Boom, we've made him into a Navi clone, and he's going to... It was kind of Aliens-esque, this troop of kind of marine grunts that are going to find and hunt Jake down. That's my point. It's like, okay, you'll do that in a second, and people aren't going to go, hang on a minute. Let's just fucking explain that for a second. How is all his memories in that little box?
But it's fine.
Yeah, no, it's fine. It's like, you can just go with it. It's like the Chris Nolan thing. It's like, whose dream am I in now? It's like, you've just got to pick, you've just got to keep up, kids. I think you could easily done the same with his best friend as a space whale.
I like that it took its time.
That's okay. We're not going to disagree.
Because it helped me just be more swept up within the world. And I know there's other scenes that actually do that, like Scorny Weaver and how she interacts with the world around her and stuff like that. And
oh, Jesus, there's another stuff. Like, there's stuff where she's just sitting staring at sand and you're like, come on.
Part of me thinks that's leaning somewhere maybe in future installments, but I don't know just yet. It's hard to know. It's one of those things probably until we
get... James, if you're listening, email in. Is Sigourney Weaver's character staring at sand going anywhere?
It could be. Could be. Well, the thing is, I heard the next installment...
Maybe it's all misdirection. Yeah.
Well, maybe. But the thing is, the next one's going to a fair world, apparently. But we're getting Vin Diesel and Michelle Yeoh because they actually film their stuff. You know, they did 2 and 3 back to back.
It's because they love family, that's why.
Yeah, exactly. That was the deal breaker for Vin Diesel. It's like, here, you have to establish family in 2
like,
or
we can
I'm
offer you
three.
£5 million, Vin. No, it's not enough. 6? No. Okay, we'll offer you £5 million and the whole base is on family. Sold.
I'm in. As long as I play like a fair Navi.
Yeah.
And I have to be cool.
I'd maybe just like it if just randomly just Riddick just happens to appear.
Could be.
There we go, crossing the universe. Right. Okay, so Quaritch is back in sorts. There's a child of Quaritch. I don't remember being in the first one.
No. There seems to be a lot of retrofit, and the fact that it's just like, oh yeah, remember you're going in that big battle at the end, yeah? We're going to take all your memories up to that point just in case you die. Mm-hmm. And then the fact that brings in Yo Spider, his son, who stays on Pandora after the humans leave.
This is maybe more me than anything else. So there's Spider in this, but I kept thinking about Spider from Coronation Street. This is one for the kids. Because Spider, I think, came back recently in Coronation Street.
I thought of Spider in Goodfellas. I was waiting for Joe Pesci to show up and start shooting at him. That's all I could think of. I was like, oh no. No, get that out of my head. But it went soon enough, just as I was getting into the film.
Dance.
Yeah. I don't think it's great. I've done great before.
Right. Yes, so we have him back. And then there's this kind of plot that's kind of, as I mentioned, there's an eco theme. So these space wheels are being hunted now by mankind because it helps. Is it prevent aging or prevents brain disorders? Like, I think it's aging.
Aging,
it stops the aging.
Aging.
So they're being hunted, and this is what I mean, these big, massive, big whales, and they're being hunted for literally, like, milligrams of this. So we get all that, and we kind of get the references here to kind of the whaling industry that's, you know, mostly, I believe, this is me being ignorant as Northern Irish 40-year-old male, has mostly kind of been outlawed. I know it still kind of exists, I believe, illegally.
I think in some international waters they still do it.
They still do it. Yeah. So that's brought in. There's an element, as I mentioned, of kind of Moby Dick. So we have these amazing hover boats hunting. I mean, those sequences I find really tough. The hunting, like you were talking about sequences kind of with Space Whale. I mean, I didn't cry when, you know, Jake's son was having a big chat about, how was your day? All good? Yeah. What did you do? I don't know where I went with that one. But the sequences where we see these whales being hunted, I find it really tough. And I guess it's intentionally there to kind of shock us as audiences to go, well, you know, yeah, this is not just happening in Pandora. This is happening and has happened over the years here. Brought back memories for me from Star Trek 4.
Oh, yeah, that's the... I haven't seen it, but I know it's got something to do with whales.
Yeah, there's a lot of... in that. So, yeah, those are the two films I'm throwing in as reference points, Star Trek 4 and Moby Dick. We've got a lot in there. That sequence I find really tough. But, I mean, he's back. I don't know. I mean, I like the kind of nods to and the callbacks to Aliens and the kind of Marines. The James Cameron knows how to do all that kind of stuff, how to get grunts kind of interacting with each other. I know he said his attitudes have changed towards gun violence and all that stuff. But I don't know. It takes a certain element of risk out of the feature. When we know in this film, in this world now, characters who die can be reincarnated. And characters who die that are from Earth can just be brought as clones. So, I mean, there is an element at the very end of this film. I think the film makes an interesting decision in where it's going to go or where it might potentially go in the third one, where a character, you think they're dead, and it just so happens someone saves them. So you're like, because I was kind of going, I said, well, that character's, he might be dead. He or she might be dead. But you've still got these, this gives away that whole kind of, there's no point in being mysterious. You've still got all his records. You could just bring him back again. I'm waving my phone at Joe, by the way, just imagining. You know,
I can see the records just in the air.
Yeah, but you know what I mean? That kind of takes the risk out of everything going forward. It's the kind of thing, it's like bringing back the Fast and Furious characters that are supposedly the dead.
Gal Gadot's coming back in one of them.
Gal Gadot's coming back.
She fell out of a plane. the thing is, right, what you're saying is right, but at the same time, I felt genuine stakes throughout it because you could feel that any character could die at any moment, especially in the third act when a major character does die and they don't follow the logic you just explained because of who they are. So then you're like, well, whoa, it hits you.
But do they not, though? Because then...
Can we talk about the thing?
Yeah, let's. We've said there's spoilers.
The Jake and Neytiri's oldest son dies.
Yeah,
but he's a Navi. You know, he's not someone you could really clone.
But he is then seen being sent back to Mother Earth or the whatever they call it. Yeah, they put him out to sea and then he floats down and then he's kind of.
Oh, he's one with AOL and all that.
AOL, it's one. Not yeah, AOL. I hate AOL from my fucking days of broadband back in the days, bastards. But I don't know. I could see him being. Reincarnated. I don't know where I went with reincarnated of sorts.
No, it's like even going back to the MCU, like when James Gunn talks about, he's always constantly going, oh, you're going to bring back this character? And he's like, nope, they're dead. That's it.
He didn't say it right. They said they did.
Yeah, pretty much.
Yeah, they did. I don't know. I just have this sense that anybody who possibly dies on Pandora may at some point come back in some shape or form, because that's the whole thing about this kind of like, the fact that there is a big thing, subplot about reincarnation and things like that. We've mentioned with Sigourney Weaver's character, etc., that the you know, the, what is it we're calling it? Not AOL, Avi? Oh,
Ewa.
Ewa.
Yeah,
Ewa.
That's like the...
They're Mother Earth.
Gaietos. Like,
yes,
you know.
That it's all about life and life is cyclical, and you know, you live and you die and then you come back and then there is a sequence. I think it is a flashback, I'm pretty certain, where they showed the oldest son being born. I do believe that's a flashback, but part of me for a second was like, oh, has he just been reincarnated just like that? I will throw this out with the Sully children, particularly the two boys. I struggled just to go for a long time, who's who?
No, you're right. No, I did. To begin with, I was like, great, which one's which? But then it's only whenever you see them in scenes together, you can tell just by their height difference, but that's about it. But when they go off on their separate adventures, then you're like, okay, I can kind of tell the difference. But at the same time, it is very difficult. Like, you should have had maybe something more distinguishable in terms of how
one
you
of
look.
Them should have worn a hat.
Exactly.
It's a cowboy hat.
Cowboy hat in the water and all that. Would have known straight away, boom, he's the oldest.
Pair of Speedos.
Aye.
With the hole cut out for his tail.
Because the thing is, there's no problem with identifying the youngest daughter because it's just a little child.
Yeah.
It's easy enough.
She's easy enough. Sigourney Weaver's character is easy enough because, like,
you can see a bit of Sigourney Weaver in her face.
And then there is a sequence, because we're in spoiler territory, where there's a dream sequence of sorts where she meets Sigourney Weaver's character from the first film.
Yeah, her mother, technically.
Yeah, and it's weird in the fact that they're both doing the same voice, and you're like, that's both Sigourney Weaver. But, you know, hey, I will pay to watch Sigourney Weaver in pretty much anything.
Yeah.
So it's a minor, but I just was a little thing was like, well, that's a little bit weird. But I don't know, that was one of my gripes that I had scribbled down, but I don't have my notes in front of me. You wouldn't know, listeners, that this is a show I didn't really record for, or I didn't really prepare for. But I had made that note at the time, that's like some of the two oldest children I find a little bit interchangeable.
Yeah.
And then that is why maybe I didn't have that huge punch at the end of the film that maybe you had or some other viewers have. But I will say this, You do not fuck with Zoe Saldana's character.
No.
She, no, no. Damn.
She just take that bone arrow and just fuck everything up.
Like. Yeah. See, I mean, I know a lot of people don't like the term anymore, but badass female characters. I mean, she is pretty badass in this film. You know, Jake's doing his thing. He's the grunt that's went native and things like that. And the jarhead who's trying to be move from being... And I think that's something a little bit is kind of underdeveloped, where he kind of alludes to, it's like he's a jarhead. He's trying to figure out how to be, you know, a father, how to be a husband, when all he kind of knows is war and how to fight wars and stuff. I mean, that's a little bit underdeveloped for me. Maybe that's going to be something they're going to go with down the line. But I thought there was times, I mean, Zoe Saldana's character, she isn't really given that much to do.
I mean, yeah, I agree.
I mean, she isn't, other than those sequences where we talk particularly the end upon on board the hoverboat, you know, she gets time to show herself there. And then there's stuff where that boat, we're in spoilers, is sinking, and she's got some great stuff with her daughter. But I think there's in the middle section she's lost, and there's a lot of stuff between the two brothers, this new group of Navi that they've kind of encountered, and Jake. Even Jake, to an extent, isn't really given that much to do. I don't know. I mean, I'm just rambling now. Well, but I mean, was that thought something for you?
Yeah, to an extent, but I think the purpose of that was to develop these new characters more, but it is to the detriment of, the further journey of, Jake and Neytiri, because all their interactions and their screen time is mainly like, how are we going to handle these children and this new place that we have to move to and stuff like that there. It's just basic stuff, there's nothing overly developed with it. I think the way the film concludes does open the door in the next installment for a lot more development between them two. So I'm hoping that is the case, where it's like, even Neytiri, who's lost so much in the first one, then she loses something very immediate and close in this one. You're like, how much can a person take before they completely crack? And then it's Jake, he's lost a child now, and there's a bit where he's just sort of half lashes out at his younger son, but he kind of understands at the same time. So be interesting to see how his dynamic with his family develops in the next one. But that's the thing actually that's getting me looking forward to the next one more than the first one would have.
Yeah, just hope you don't have to be like 50 by the time it's out in cinemas.
No, it's 2 years. He has it done.
Yeah,
that's why he.
Well, he has the live action stuff done. I don't know.
All the effects are like post now. He's more or less got it done.
Okay, so you and I have been largely positive about this. I think largely critics have been semi-divided on it. I know that brings me to one point. I know I did want to raise with you, because you were quite annoyed with a certain well-known film critic who I admire greatly.
So do I, to be honest.
But you were a bit peeved. And I think if you want to throw a couple of comments about that, then we will mention some. We've had some comments about Avatar, The Way of the Water.
I think the difference between the critical reception, it's weird. It seems more American film critics seem to be latching onto it more than, say, UK and European critics at large. I don't know why, to be honest with you, because it does seem like a universal sort of film that has a lot of stuff that appeals to people all over the world, which is probably why it's doing so well at the box office worldwide. My problem with that critic, I will not name him.
It's Mark Kermode.
It's Mark Kermode, yeah. His review, it wasn't really a review. That's what annoyed me. Like, when I was trying to get to understand, why didn't you like it? He just said it's dull, and then he just did a silly voice about Navi and that, and you're like, okay, that's funny once, but he does it about 20 times throughout the review, and you're going, you're a grown
did
man.
Did he go into a weird Italian-esque accent in the style of the House of Gucci? Baba da Bope.
See, that's the thing. That's funny once
or twice. We're the Navi, Baba da Bope. I'm Jared Leto, I'm a Navi.
Thank God he hasn't been signed up to do any of the films, put it that way. But that's what he seems to be doing now a lot more, just doing weird things out there.
Yeah, he's successful, Joe. Maybe that's what we need to do. Maybe we should have just scrapped this talking for nearly 40 minutes about the film and just rip the piss out of it and call it Fern Gully with Smurfs in space.
Yeah, with a bit of Free Willy and Moby Dick and everything. It's got everything, and that's why it's a pile of crap, yeah.
And talk about the Navi.
But
Italian accents. Oh, but my God, mi scusi. Oh, no, it's the way of the water.
Oh no, I'm getting like flashbacks now. I feel like I'm back in the jungles of Cambodia. I need to get in the last chopper out of Saigon.
Right. So yeah, you.
But yeah, no. It just.
I do agree with you because I had heard his review of the film before I seen it. I had read a couple of things. Empire had given it quite a strong review. Mm. I'd heard Helen O'Hara, who I admire a lot, and you know, I would listen to her thoughts and films, you know, quite often. She had been quite positive. Mark Kermit was probably the most negative. I think was it James King? I think was another one who found it very dull and long.
Mm. Bradshaw, I think, didn't like it. Yeah. I think it got like 2 out of 5.
Yeah, but Bradshaw probably just sat with his review and just told you what happened.
Yeah, but what did you think? And don't worry about that.
That's not important. That's not the point of what a film critic should do.
Yes.
But it was, as I come back to it, was you actually said, you know, Jim, I really liked it. It's like, okay, I'll give it a shot. I'll give it a go. And yeah, as I come back to my point, you liked it, I liked it. I just think there's too much of his best friend's wheel, and it kept making me think of that sequence in The Simpsons with Ron Howard.
Oh, yeah.
It did make me think of that. It's like, I can just imagine, you know, we know how James Cameron got Aliens made. He just basically went Alien, added the S, and turned the S into the dollar signs. I would imagine he just went in and said, right, well, I want to make Avatar 2. Okay, yeah, it was a lot of money, James. His best friend is a talking wheel. You've done it again, James.
Walks out with 2 money bags.
So here we go. Right, we're going to wrap up this pod, but we had a couple of comments, and one that actually feeds in well. So Patty on Twitter, who goes by the name of #IrishPatty, you know, very, you know, modern in 2022.
Very stereotypical.
He thought it was brilliant. Maybe could have done with around 20 minutes in the middle cut out.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to imagine, Patty, you were the same as me. You were like, yeah, cut out some wheels.
Yeah, if we want to watch Free Willy, you can watch Free Willy.
We've got a couple of comments here about another film we're going to be talking about in a couple of weeks. But I did see, as I scrolled through, Adam Neeson, who has been on this pod before, he's been on the TV show before. We all love Adam.
Oh, aye. Good lad, Adam.
We all love Adam, you know. We might disagree with his thoughts. You and I, well, you might disagree with his and I thoughts on Bulletproof, or not Bulletproof, Bullet Train.
No, don't. You know, done with that fake film.
We had a lot of fun with that film. But let me just get these comments up, and I'm just going to get you to do some music for a second for us, Joe. Some party music.
Right, have you got it yet?
No.
No, all right.
I've got it. Okay. So Adam, I believe, enjoyed Avatar The Way of the Water, although I'm just going to throw that into his mouth because I'm not sure exactly from this. So his questions actually was, would you enjoy seeing Arnie in Avatar form?
Yes, I actually thought when they were developing two, he was going to like sort of take over from the Quaritch role and be that sort of military heavy. He's like, yeah, Quaritch was a pussy. I'm going to actually get things done here in Pandora.
Yeah, I can see Arnie in that. You know, there's hope yet. Yeah. And then secondly, which leads us well, because as we mentioned, in a couple of weeks, we're going to be talking about True Lies, because that film's on Disney Plus. He would like to hear our best impressions of Arnie saying The Way of the Water.
Do you want to go first or will I?
Well, what I thought we would do, right, I'm going to let you go first, and I'm going to go into IMDb. I'm going to get some lines from the film. I'm going to get some quotes from the film, so I thought I might try and deliver them in an Arnie line just to open this out. So let me see. Details, keyword. This is more party music we need at this point.
Just throw in the wheels while we're at it. You know, that common, like, you know, music you get when you're on hold. It's really just wheels talking. Please hold.
Right. I can't find it. Okay, there we go. Okay, so I've got some quotes now. Okay, it's actually Arnie, just a wheel. I think he did that impression in Total Recall.
He was
ahead of the game. So yeah, so Adam would like to hear our impressions of Arnie saying The Way of the Water. I'll let you go first.
Just The Way of the Water?
Yeah.
The Way of the Water.
That's good. The Way of the Water. Let me think. So I'm going to go, so what does a heartbeat sound like? I don't know where I'm
going. I see you.
I see you. It's the way of the water, you idiot. Stop whining.
Let's get this done.
I'll be Navi.
For Ewa. See, well, that's another thing about the film. When you think about it, it doesn't really have that many memorable lines, does it?
Let me see. I'm just going to find if I get another one there. This is a home! Although that is technically...
Family is a fortress.
Get on the ship and find a seat and keep out of the way. Although that is Spider. So yes, so actually, I apologize. That's Quaritch, actually. So that would actually fit it quite well. So there we go. Mm. So I think that brings on that Annie-related note.
Put that navi down now!
Hasta la vista, Navi.
No, not doing anymore. This madness has to end.
Yes, so that's going to bring an end to this podcast. So thank you for listening. This is the start of the brand new series. We will have another episode next week. And it's a special episode. I'm going to be speaking to the producers and writers of Robin Hood, Prince of Thieves, which, you know, we talked about a couple of weeks ago on the TV show. But that's a lifetime ago away now because it was last year. But you have that to look forward to next week. So don't forget to subscribe to make sure you don't miss out. And all that's really left for me to do now is thank you very much, Joe.
Thanks very much, Jim.
Goodbye.